After studying this module, you shall be able to know the concept of cognition, learn key components of cognition which are involved in it, identify cognitive causes of various disorders, and also evaluate cognitive deficits exhibited by serious disorders. Given the diversity of cognitive problems, cognitive domains such as executive functions, attentions, and memory emerge most frequently at risk. Specificity of cognitive impairment across disorders, the relationship of these deficits with the underlying psychopathology, neurobrain images of these disorders, and also the impact of impairments on treatment implications need to be explored. So let's start with what is cognition. Cognition is the ability to process information and draw inferences, which lies unique to the human species. This specific ability in broad sense is called cognition and includes the key components such as attention, memory, thinking, learning, perception, motivation, and language. Throughout life, it can be broadly described as an interaction between knowledge-driven processes and sensory processes, and between control processes and automatic processes. Among the specific aspects that may be used to gauge the functioning of cognition and judgment, use and manipulations of symbols, perception, acquisition of skills, etc. is important. Deficits in such area may lead to problems in thinking critically, planning and organizing, and paying attention and processing the information, even in recalling and working upon the information simultaneously, initiating speech and responding to information simultaneously. Therefore, certain questions need to be answered in context of psychiatric disorders and cognitive impairments. So, what these questions will be? What is the profile of cognitive impairment in psychiatric disorders? How does cognitive impairment relate to other genetic and sociocultural factors? And also, do these cognitive deficits vary over a period of time or they remain same? And fourth, how does cognitive impairment impact the prognosis of the disorder? So these were the certain questions which needs to be answered. Now let's come to key cognitive domains. Cognitive impairments share a good relationship or a major relationship with the nature and magnitude of the pathology. Therefore, it becomes extremely important to understand key cognitive domains in brief. First is the working memory. It deals with holding information in mind and simultaneously working or manipulating the information. It involves higher mental activities such as being able to relate one idea to another, performing mental maths, relating previous information with the new learnt information, and sequencing the information. It entails the capacity to hold a particular set of information online for a brief span and later either use the information or manipulate it to draw conclusions for cognitive behavioral task. Working memory is believed to be extremely vital in order to have a multi-dimensional view of thought or action, critical thinking, execute action plans, and further to enhance the creativity. Now, what are the executive functions? Recent attempts have defined executive functions as those which indulge in complex cognitions such as concept formations, solving novel questions, assimilations, adaptations, developing strategic approach, or sequencing complex actions. In another modern view, executive functions are identified as a product of the co-coordinated operations of various processes to accomplish a particular goal in a flexible manner. These functions are also viewed as playing a very critical role in construction of mature cognitions. Now let's understand the gist of it. In other words, we can say working memory, inhibitions, task switching emerge as major components of frontal lobe functions, in a term used simultaneously to executive functions, thinking and reasoning. The process of cognitive rearrangements and manipulations of events facilitating adaptations to the environment is conceived as thinking. It is perceived to be a constructive process of creating new schemas with active assimilations and accommodation process. Thinking involves interactions of various other mental activities such as reasoning, problem solving, judgment, abstractions, deductions, etc. The organization of knowledge in hierarchy and system is provided by concepts of knowledge and by concepts which are clearly manifested in behavior than explicitly seen. Reasoning, on the other hand, emerges from logical thinking and inference to seek solution to a problem. Rationalizing events based on stored information, experiences, knowledge, rule, encompass goal-directed thinking. Reasoning is broadly of two types, deductive reasoning and inductive reasoning. Deductive reasoning allows drawing of inferences from set of assertions, whereas inductive reasoning deals with development of general assumptions based on small evidences. Both types of reasoning are goal-oriented and are aimed at problem-solving. Now let's understand cognitive causes and symptomatology in various disorders. One of the major etiological factors of various psychiatric disorders lies in the basis and deficits of information processing ability. As a result, many times deficits in cognitive symptoms such as poor attention, memory, perception, inhibitory control, cognitive flexibility may surface. Some of the common disorders with focus on the cognitive roots and symptoms are discussed now. Schizophrenia is the first one which we will be discussing. One of the most psychotic disorders with not a very healthy prognosis is schizophrenia. It is marked by serious impairments in thought process, emotions and behaviors. Broadly, there are four types of schizophrenia: catatonic, herbiphrenic, paranoid and mixed type. Each one of the types in symptoms include both positive and negative symptoms. Positive symptoms may include a complete fragmentations of the thought process and perception leading to hallucinations or delusions. On the other hand, the negative symptoms may involve flat affect, psychomotor retardations, social withdrawal. Schizophrenic patients are generally unable to make sense of the sensory information, and in their acute phase, they lose their ability to take care of their personal needs and grooming. Whereas the etiology of schizophrenia can be viewed from biopsychosocial perspective, depicting interplay of genetic vulnerabilities, psychological stressors and socio-cultural pressures. However, restricting our view only psychological causes in order to understand the cognitive roots, it can be gained that following factors are also potentially leading to schizophrenia. Number one is childhood abuse or trauma. Second is your family dysfunction, such as separations in families, loss of loved one, and even lack of self-esteem, poor identity is also there, and double meaning in communication, hostility, and lack of control in relationships is also responsible for schizophrenia. The understanding of various psychological factors in causation of schizophrenia perhaps leads to occurrence of certain cognitive deficits. Such fundamental deficits in schizophrenia become core features and may precipitate functional impairments in the individuals. The deficits may appear to be stable over a period of time and in certain cases may also persist even after remission. The cognitive lack may appear in broad areas such as working memory, executive functions, attentions and information processing, and even in your memory too. In case of working memory, limited capacity to hold an information and simultaneously be able to work upon the material is depicted in the patient. It could be attributed to the hypofunction of the prefrontal cortex. It may also result in formal thought disorder and lead to total disassociation of thoughts. Weakening of the long-term memory in terms of free and sequential recall may also be exhibited. Intellectual impairment and poor visual control coordination also emerges as a core feature of the unique pathology. Verbal, episodic, and visual memory also seems to be largely affected in schizophrenia. Most of the cognitive deficits vary depending on the nature of symptoms. Thus, we can say that schizophrenia is basically, it is not in terms of treatment, developments in psychopharmacological and neuropsychological field, but it also suggests better methods to deal with cognitive and social functions. Now, let's understand what is mood disorders. What are mood disorders? Mood disorders are also called affective disorders, characteristically involved oscillation of mood in cycles of depression and mania. Fluctuations in mood may be more intense and pervasive than normal mood swings. The transition from high to low mood in some cases may be completely dramatic, while in other situations it may be gradual and slow, alternating with periods of normal mood in between as well. Symptoms of depression or mania both can be severe and lead to cognitive impairments. Mania may exhibit feelings of euphoria, increased psychomotor activities, flight of ideas, hallucinations, impulsivity and sociability, etc. On the other hand, depressive episodes involve feeling of pervasive sadness, helplessness, hopelessness, social withdrawal, social thinking, poor memory, pessimistic ideas, delusions, poor psychomotor activity, etc. The causes of the disorder can be attributed to stressful life events, quality of family relationships, emotional expressiveness among the family members, specific attitudes such as perfectionism, self-criticality, traumatic events. So all these are dependent for your mood disorders. The relationship between mood and cognition is dynamic as a result of state and trait-dependent components. The trait-dependent features may provide an insight into the genetic vulnerabilities, neurological deficits, and brain abnormalities. Neurocognitive deficits are very strongly present in mood disorders and as well reflected in performance, test for attention, executive functions, and memory. In acute phase of mania, the patient may exhibit short attention span and high distractibility, lack of planning, organizing, and impulsivity in execution is clearly seen. However, in case of comparison between two phases, the cognitive intactness seems to be better in depression than in mania. Also, high correlation of nature and strengths of deficits with duration of illness is seen. The third factor out here is depression. One of the most common psychiatric disorder is depression, which is characterized by feelings of sadness, helplessness, hopelessness, guilt, disturbance in sleep pattern, lack of appetite, loss of libido, social withdrawal, etc. Depression seems to be more common in females than in males, and recent research basically suggests increasing prevalence of childhood depression as well. Mild depression can be treated through professional psychotherapy, whereas moderate to severe depression would require medical interventions. Attempts are being made to understand the causes of depression. Besides the genetic factors, cognitive models have gained prominence and acceptance as well. According to the cognitive theory, the cognition or one's thought and beliefs are potentially determine the emotions and behaviors of a person. Also, Beck has found evidence that deviation from logical and realistic thinking was found at every level of depression, from mild neurotic to severe psychotic. This model also asserts that three specific ideas are coming out: cognitive trait, which is negative view of self, world and future; cognitive schemas, patterns of maladaptive thoughts and beliefs, cognitive errors, faulty thinking and reasoning which is there. This chronic negative belief pattern later becomes a mode for a template of thinking, giving rise to negative emotions and subsequent maladaptive behaviors. Thus, we can say that since according to that what Beck has referred, the behavioral consequences of psychopathology will depend on the content of cognitive structuring. Therefore, a change in the emotions of sadness would intimate or initiate with the correction of dysfunctional thought process. In view of cognitive deficits, various studies have suggested presence of neuropsychological deficits in the area of verbal, memory, visual and executive functions. Even impaired concentration, slowness in thinking, repetitive, intrusive thoughts, indecisive nature is also being present out here in our disorder of depression. Now let's come to the next disorder, which is your obsessive compulsive disorder, also termed as OCD. It is one of most important or most debilitating anxiety disorder, and it is potentially disabling conditions that can persist throughout an individual's life. The patient tends to trapped in a pattern of repetitive thoughts and behaviors that may occur senseless and distressing to others but are extremely difficult to overcome. Obsessions can be defined as unwanted ideas, images or impulses that repeatedly intrude in the conscious awareness of the individual. It is completely recognized as irrational, absurd, yet the patient is unable to resist, which leads to marked distress. A view of etiological theories of OCD suggests psychological, biological and neuropsychological factors. Cognitive model of OCD proposes dysfunctional beliefs, maladaptive expectations to be the major cause of anxiety. Two major cognitive biases that lead to catastrophic misinterpretations of intrusive thoughts have also been outlined. First bias involves the belief that thinking about an unpleasant situation makes it more approximate to occurrence, and the second bias or the moral bias states that holding an immoral thought is equivalent to doing an immoral action. Let's come to the next disorder, which is the somatoform disorder. Somatoform disorders are characterized by repeated presentations of physical complaints without any adequate physical basis to explain it. Such complaints appear to be truly medical in origin but cannot be explained in terms of physical disease. Result of any substance abuse or any other psychiatric disorder is there. The patient seems to show a persistent request for investigations and treatments in spite of repeated assurance by the doctors. Somatoform disorder is generally found to be more common in females, whereas alcoholism and psychopathy are more prevalent in males. This pathology is many times considered to be idiom of stressors. In case of patient's significant other is able to fetch out strong secondary gains from something, somatizing imitation of the pathological behavior is an easy way for the patient. Cultural influence may also be a part of it, which would be your black magic or specific border sensations are also seen an imperative factor in triggering of this disorder. In the context of cognitive deficits, poor concentration is there with decreased memory for recent events, and poor word completion is also seen. Spatial abilities, slow processing speed, impaired working memory, poor learning, set thinking or set shifting, planning and poor inhibitory control may surface as major cognitive symptoms. About 70 to 85% of the patients exhibit cognitive impairments and strongly contribute to the individual's social and occupational dysfunctions. Interventions targeting the stress and other factors such as supportive psychotherapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, relaxation therapy may prove to be very effective. Next disorder is your eating disorder. Eating disorders exhibit extreme disturbances in eating behavior. It distinguishes itself from the normal eating patterns or disturbances in terms of its intensity and manifestations. There are three types of eating disorders. First is anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, and eating disorders not otherwise specified. It has also been seen that the occurrence of eating disorders can be attributed to a set of biological, psychological, and sociological factors. Considering only the cognitive factors, the cognitive theory behind eating disorders reveals that the individuals tend to excessively define and evaluate own self in terms of weight and shape. As a result, the cognitive structures unite the views of self with the body and shape, which further exerts an automatic influence on the processing of the food-related stimuli. People with eating disorders tend to exhibit distortions in the processing of food-related information, such as attentional and memory biases while dealing with food stimuli. We could also see that such self-pressures will persuade for thinness emerges at the nucleus and encourage the individual to diet excessively. This cycle of strict dieting and then suddenly to repeated boosts of uncontrolled overeating accompanied by intense fear of weight gain emerges as a strong cognitive and behavioral challenge. In view of cognitive deficits, anorexia is associated with high levels of metacognitive capacities accompanied with lack of positive self-beliefs. In case of bulimia, poor self-esteem is accompanied with biased judgment and information capacity. Or it has been said that effective treatment approach should be taken to improve the cognitive factors which are involved in eating disorders. Next disorder would be your borderline personality disorder. Personality can be viewed as deeply ingrained pattern of behavior that includes moods, modes of perception, relating to others, thinking about oneself and the environment. Personality disorders emerge when such personality attributes turn abnormal, maladaptive, and cause significant social or occupational impairments accompanied by or marked by distress. Borderline personality disorders is characterized with persistent disturbance of identity of self for X, who am I? Psychological causes of these disorders would be your problems with the cognitive, emotional regulation is believed to be the epicenter of these disorders. In view of cognitive deficits, recent research has revealed poor decision making among them, skills in problem solving is not there, and thus cueing strategies and treatments of such patients may prove very helpful. Therefore, another significant finding in such patients was that suicidal ideations and attempts were related to cognitive functioning than the more obviously thought level of depression is there. Next disorder is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which we also say ADHD. This syndrome was first described by Heinrich Hoff in 1854. Since then, it has known with variety of names such as minimal brain dysfunctions, hyperkinactive syndrome, and Strauss syndrome. Children fail to finish things they have started, shift from one uncompleted activity to another, get easily distracted by external stimuli, have difficulties sitting at one place, interfere in any other people's activity, absence of thinking before acting, problem in waiting for turn to come, and are extremely fidgety. Since ADHD is a developmental disorder, biological factors also seem to play a strong role than pure psychological causes. Genetic predispositions and vulnerability is recognized as vital factor out here. Now, what are the cognitive deficits in ADHD? ADHD is primarily related to areas of attention and memory. Weak evidence for deficits in the areas of visuospatial and visuomotor functioning are found in ADHD children. Various deficits in the areas of cognitive flexibility, inhibitory control, working memory, planning, organizing are further involved in disorder. Let's understand what all we have done till now with a recap or a summary. Cognitions can be defined as information processing, the capacity of an individual with various facets such as attention, memory, learning, perception, etc. The key cognitive domains where general deficits are depicted are working memory, cognitive flexibility, inhibitory control, thinking, and reasoning. In case of schizophrenia, major deficits are viewed in areas of executive functions and attention and memory. Mood disorders reflects deficits in area of impulsivity, planning, organizing, and intelligence. Obsessive compulsive disorder exhibits deficits in primarily in areas of visuospatial ability, implicit memory, selective attention, and executive functions. Eating disorder patients depict cognitive impairments in attention, memory, thought, shape, fusion, thin ideal interrelationships. ADHD children basically show functional impairments in attention, inhibitory control, visual spatial activities, abilities, and even in working memories.